بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هتكلم النهاردة عن موضوع أنيميا and the heart. لحظة أذهب بس هنا. Anemia is very common in patients with heart diseases. Generally, it's present in approximately 1/3 of patients with congestive heart failure and 10 to 20% of patients with coronary artery disease. Causes of anemia in a cardiac patient are not fully understood. Several factors contribute, including iron deficiency, comorbid chronic kidney disease, blunted erythropoietin production, hemodilution, aspirin-induced gastrointestinal blood loss, use of RAS blockers, cytokine-mediated inflammation, and gut malabsorption with consequent nutritional deficiencies. Anemia can worsen cardiac function and is associated with poor outcomes, including increased risk for hospitalization and death, decreased exercise capacity, and poor quality of life. Anemia can cause heart failure, anemic heart failure, and heart failure, chronic heart failure, can cause anemia. Chronic heart failure is a chronic process which causes increased pro-inflammatory cytokines, decreasing iron available for erythropoiesis, impairing erythropoiesis. Also, reduced cardiac output causes renal impairment with decreased renal erythropoietin secretion and impaired also erythropoiesis. And neurohormonal activation that is present causes renal impairment and causes fluid overload, which causes hemodilution and anemia. Also, aspirin and anticoagulants causes blood losses through minor gastrointestinal tract injury and causing anemia. Possible sequence of events involved in the pathogenesis of heart failure in chronic severe anemia. With chronic severe anemia, there is peripheral vasodilatation, causes dropped blood pressure and increasing neurohormones like catecholamines, decreasing renal blood flow and the glomerular filtration rate, increasing salt and water retention, increasing extracellular volume and plasma volume, increasing workload, LV mass, LV remodeling, and LV dysfunction, worsening heart failure. Anemia is defined as hemoglobin concentration 13 grams per deciliter or less in men and 12 grams per deciliter or less in women. It's common in heart failure, particularly in hospitalized patients, more common in women, elderly, patients with renal impairment, and is associated with advanced myocardial remodeling, inflammation, and volume overload. Iron deficiency per se without anemia is common in heart failure, as it is with other chronic illnesses, and it can lead to anemia and or skeletal muscle dysfunction without anemia. Within a heart failure population, iron deficiency is associated with worse prognosis. Intravenous ferric carboxymaltose, FCM, has been shown to improve self-reported patient global assessment, quality of life, and NEHA class over 6 months in the FAIR heart failure trial, both in anemic and non-anemic patients with heart failure. In the CONFIRM heart failure trial, exercise capacity improved over 24 weeks. In the analysis of secondary endpoints in the CONFIRM heart failure trial, IV iron reduced the risk of heart failure hospitalization in iron deficient patients with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. A meta-analysis of IV iron therapy in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction patients with iron deficiency over up to 52 weeks showed reduced hospitalization rates and improved heart failure symptoms, exercise capacity, and quality of life with iron therapy. Effect of treating iron deficiency in heart failure preserved ejection fraction or minimally reduced ejection fraction, and the long-term safety of iron therapy in either heart failure with reduced ejection fraction or mildly reduced ejection fraction or preserved ejection fraction is unknown. Also, safety of IV iron is unknown in patients with heart failure and hemoglobin more than 15 grams per deciliter. Patients with iron deficiency need to be screened for any potentially treatable or reversible causes, gastrointestinal sources of bleeding, for example. in the 2016 European guidelines for heart failure, acute and chronic heart failure, intravenous ferric carboxy maltose should be considered in symptomatic patients with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction and iron deficiency, meaning serum ferritin less than 100 microgram per liter, or ferritin between 100 and 299 microgram per liter, and transferrin saturation less than 20%, in order to alleviate heart failure symptoms and improve exercise capacity and quality of life. This is class 2A. Ferric carboxy maltose is administered via drip infusion up to a maximum of single dose of 1,000 milligram of iron, but not exceeding 15 milligram per kg, or the calculated, calculated cumulative dose, or bolus injection at a maximum single dose of up to 100 milligram of iron up to 3 times per week. There is a large ongoing study called the Iron Man study, which will address whether the additional use of intravenous iron ferric isomaltoside 1000 on top of standard care will improve the outlook of the outcome for patients with heart failure and iron deficiency or not. Those are the primary outcome measures and secondary outcome measures for this study. Primary will be in the form of cardiovascular mortality or hospitalization for worsening heart failure. Secondary is for all-cause mortality, cardiovascular mortality or first hospitalization for major cardiovascular events, quality of life, days dead or hospitalized at 2.5 years, quality adjusted days alive, cardiovascular hospitalization, all-cause hospitalization, death due to sepsis, meaning risk of iron transfusion, hospitalization primarily for infection. This study is estimated to enroll 1,300 patients. It started in February 2016. It's estimated to complete in August 2020. Also, anemia is related to acute coronary syndromes. It's common in patients hospitalized for acute coronary syndrome, and its prevalence ranges from 6.4 to 45% in different studies. Persistent or worsening anemia in patients with acute coronary syndrome is strongly associated with increased mortality, recurrent MI, and major bleeds. However, it is uncertain if anemia itself is a determinant for poorer outcome or it is a marker of comorbid conditions. In the setting of acute coronary syndrome, it is critical to identify the cause of anemia, particularly occult bleeds. Choice of antithrombotic agents need to be carefully weighed and weigh ischemic and bleeding risk. In the setting of anemia related to an unknown or untreatable source, use of a drug-eluting stent should be restricted. The nadir hemoglobin, lowest hemoglobin cutoff value, mandating transfusion is not standardized and varies among hospitals. There are two strategies. One called a liberal blood transfusion strategy, and it is defined as transfusion at hemoglobin level less than 9 grams per deciliter, while as other is restrictive blood transfusion strategy, which starts at a level of less than 7 grams per deciliter. The liberal transfusion strategy was associated with increased all-cause mortality compared with no blood transfusion or restrictive transfusion strategy. Only at an adhere hematocrit more than 25%, meaning liberal transfusion is risky only if the hematocrit is more than 25%. With hematocrit less than or equal 24%, transfusions were associated with in-hospital mortality reduction, and between 25 and 30%, transfusions had a neutral effect, while in those with hematocrit more than 30, significant increase in mortality was observed with transfusion. Effect of erythropoiesis stimulating agents on outcomes of acute coronary syndrome patients with anemia has not been investigated. However, accumulated evidence on these compounds in patients with congestive heart failure strongly suggests that these have non-beneficial effects on mortality rates and may be harmful due to increased risk of thromboembolism, stroke, and hypertension. The American College of Physicians guidelines state that it recommends using a restrictive red blood cell transfusion strategy with trigger hemoglobin threshold 7 to 8 grams per deciliter compared with higher hemoglobin levels in hospitalized patients with coronary artery disease. also recommends against the use of erythropoiesis stimulating agents in patients with mild to moderate anemia and congestive heart failure or coronary artery disease. Anemia is also present usually in patients with valvular heart disease. Causes of anemia in patients with valvular heart disease without heart failure include association with infective endocarditis due to toxemia, and it implies worse prognosis and more severe case. Also, it is sometimes related to mechanical valve hemolysis. Anemia can also be associated with multiple cardiac symptoms like chest pain, shortness of breath, palpitations, dizziness, and adequate investigations may be needed to exclude cardiac disease in the setting of anemia. Thank you.